Hey guys, what's going on? This is David Chen. You're on another edition of Panonomics Podcast, and we are excited entering season four out the door. And the first guest of this year for season four is my brother from another mother, the one and only, the cold-blooded. I got that Cole shirt on. My boy, Norris Cole. Norris, how you doing, my man?
What's going on? The champ is in the building. How you doing?
The champ is in the building. Now, Norris, you are a two-time champion, defending champion. You are an educator. You are a gamer. You are a fitness expert. You are a human being overall. Tell us a little bit more about Norris Cole and what's he doing right now and about where he is in his current life.
Well, right now, Norris Cole has a few things that he's valuing that's, you know, of high importance. Obviously, health. You know, I believe health is wealth. So, you know, I work out regularly a couple times a day, about 5 days a week, you know, taking care of your body, you know, making sure I'm eating the right nutrition, the right foods, you know, trying to stay young as long as possible. you know, like you say, I'm an educator. I've gotten into that space, sharing information on team building, on how to build championship teams, you know, knowing your role, whether it's in business, whether it's in family, whether it's in the actual sports, you know, setting. And also, I'm still playing. You know, I'm a free agent at the moment, but I'm still playing. Obviously, part of that working out a couple times a day is basketball, you know, staying sharp, you know, still fast, still got the quick twitch. Still got that hunger to play. And also, you know, we're in the entrepreneur space, you know, trying to build different businesses, you know, esports, real estate, you know. So, you know, I have a lot going on right now, but, you know, you only got one life, you know, and we got to live it to the fullest. And, you know, I'm all about taking care of myself and taking care of my family. So it's never too much at this point.
It never is. And these are all blessings upon blessings that you have. You know, you're at a really young age at 34 years old, still doing amazing things, still playing in tip-top condition. We were hanging out with each other, I think, 2 weeks ago, and I remember seeing you. And the one comment I made to you is, man, you're the only person I've met that is consistent in the off-season as they're on the off-season that you're ready to go at any single time. And I commended you on your preparation and that mental health, and that mental attitude of always being ready and having that championship mindset. Tell me about that. Was that something that you were ingrained in as a child that then helped shape you to become a champion? Tell me where you got that from.
Well, I always believe training and your upbringing and your surrounding plays a part in who you actually become. And so I was blessed to have, you know, two parents that believed in hard work and consistency. And I just tried to take that to the next level. And for professional sports, it's one of the most rare careers you can have. You know, it's like less than 1% get to say they play in the NBA, get to say they play, you know, professional sports. And so it's a highly, highly competitive space. And so you have to always stay ready. You never know when you're going to get an opportunity. And when you get that opportunity, you have to be ready to flourish. And so from my training, my upbringing, from my family, my mother, my father, my coaches that I had in high school, college, and, you know, having Coach Spo, you know, you have to always stay ready. It's part of being professional. As a professional, you have to always be ready to give an account. You have to always be ready to show your talent and show what you can do. And so I try to make that a lifestyle for me. It's truly a lifestyle. I don't do it just for basketball. I do it as a lifestyle. I feel like I'm always prepared for any situation life can throw at me, and that's what I try to do. I try to chase that perfection.
You know, what's amazing is you talk about this perfection of always being prepared. And nor was that highlighted better when you were getting drafted your first season and you're coming in and you hear that you're going to Miami with the big three, Jesus Shuttlesworth, and an amazing Pat Riley coach. Tell me that feeling when you knew that was happening and how that made you feel with your always be ready mentality.
Well, no, when you get drafted, you're just excited to make it.
Yeah, I bet.
The hardest part is
making it. Right? That's you're like, hardest. Oh, yeah, finally.
Yeah, the hardest part is just making it. So hearing your name called, no matter where you go, you get excited. Woo. But then knowing that I was going to a highly competitive team, a championship, you know, level team, I wanted to, you know, show that I was worthy of being on the court to help contribute to winning. I didn't want to be one of those guys that just, you know, sat on the bench. I wanted to be a guy that got drafted and went to a team and contributed to winning right away. And I was fortunate enough and I was able to do that. And I'm appreciative for, you know, Spo seeing the hard work that I put in and my teammates trusting me to put me out there as a young player.
You know, what's amazing about that is you talk about that night and I saw this big, gigantic smile on your face. Yeah. Tell me about that, man, because most people don't ever get experience the moment where it's just like, wow, tell us how that felt.
It's like that. It's like that moment.
Yeah, right.
It's like, you know, I mean, the best way I can describe it, it's like a real dream come true. Not everyone gets their dream come true. You know, a lot of times growing up, you think about, man, I want to be this. I want to be a firefighter. I want to play in the NBA. I want to play in the NFL. I want to be a police officer. I want to be the president. You know, but most people never get to actually live their true dream. This was my dream job that I always wanted. So it was like a feeling of like, you know, almost like heaven on earth. You know what I mean? It was like all the hard work you put in. You know, when people say anything is possible, this was that redefining moment. Like, you know what? Yes, anything is possible. I'm actually living my dream. And so that's what it felt like. And then obviously the emotional part with my family, being with the people who have been there with me from day one, my you know, the people who've made the sacrifices with me and for me, you know, being able to share with them, that was real cool as well.
You know, it's so amazing because you talk about that awe moment and you raise up your hands and going from there. And I remember an awe moment where you raised up your hands and you went from there. And this is a discussion that me and Stan Van Grumpy have had going back and forth. And it was when they got the ball to Ray at that three, you turned and your hands went up and that shot went out. You knew it was going in. And me and him gone back and forth. I was like, did he know? But I know you want to know that you have that confidence though. Tell me about that at that moment and how you anticipate and work on that to where you knew you had that moment again.
Well, when you on a team in any workspace, you got to believe, you know, you want to believe in your teammates. You want to believe in your work, your workmates. You want to believe in your family. And so for me, I always try to give off energy that I want returned back to me. When I'm on the court, I want you believing in me. I want you to believe when I shoot the ball, you're going to believe it's going to go in. I want you to believe that when I'm out there trying to make plays, that you believe that I can make those plays. And so at that time, you know, I seen Ray practice, you know, those backpedal threes, you know, all the time. And so when the moment happened to, you know, happen in real time, I mean, I knew it was going in. I didn't have no doubt. You know, and that's the type of team player that I am. Whether it's me making a play or whether it's my teammate making a play, whether it's me solving the problem in the family or whether it's one of my family members solving the problem, whether it's you as a business partner coming with the deal or whether it's me coming with the deal, I'm going to be excited either way because the team is going to win and benefit from it. And I'm going to believe in you to make sure that you close the deal. And so that's what it was. You know, Ray, you know, Chris got the ball. Ray, you know, happened to do his back pedal three. And I just had faith that it was going in because that's just the type of, you know, team player that I am. I believe in my crew.
It's amazing, man. You talk about that confidence, that championship mindset, and you saw that transition from the court. And I recently saw that when you came and you joined us at ConnectX, you know, and it's a stunning event that we have. And you were a star of the show. Everyone was so amazed by how nice you were and how genuine you were and how friendly you were and how great the things we did. You were on a panel about championship mindset. It was yourself, 5-time nominated Emmy actor Donovan Carter for Virtual Ballers, 2-time Grammy nominated Christina Eustace, and then you. When you're sitting in a mindset, your championship mindset, you're going on there. You're 21 years old. You're coming at a young age. Coming into the league, playing these guys, maybe you were younger at that point, coming in and playing, you had a maturity that had to be conditioned to earn the respect. And I think a lot of times when you talk about young people or new people entering an industry, it doesn't matter if it's wrestling, it doesn't matter if it's business, it doesn't matter what it is. They tend to not understand how to fit in where they want to come in and just grind in and smash. And then they don't understand the ecosphere or the harmony that is needed in that championship realm. And that's a mindset. Can you explain to us and our viewers how you use that in your framework of that champion mindset to succeed in things that you've done?
Well, I had to go back to the conditioning, the training. I've always played team sports. I didn't do too many individual sports. So at a young age, you know, I played for the Salvation Army growing up on a team. My high school team was pretty good. We won 2 state championships, and I wasn't always the best player on the team. So I learned how to play with other good players and learn how to fit in. You know, I might have 3 or 4 skill sets. Another good player might only have 1 or 2. So I'll let him do what he's good at, his 1 or 2, because I'm adaptable. I can do the other things. And so I learned that. And then obviously at Cleveland State, you see I'm wearing my Cleveland State shirt. My coach, you know, he always believed in, you know, good energy is always going to be rewarded. You know, being on the bench or being in the game and not having a great attitude, that's going to cost you in the moment of truth. It's not going to cost you against a team that you're supposed to beat. It's going to cost you in the moment of truth when you need everything to work right. And so I always try to have a purity, a pure mindset. And, you know, when you have that pure mindset for your team, you're able to bring harmony to a situation, because anybody can sense a fake. You know, everybody can sense when it's fake energy, when it's fake love. And so I always was authentic, always, you know, truly, genuinely wanted to win. In order to win, I know it's not going to always be about me. Sometimes it's going to be about me. Other times it's not going to be about me. But all the time it's about the team.
You know, what's so beautiful about that is understanding your place and understanding how to work and flow with water. Yes. Is a much more easier concept universally than sitting there and standing against this water. And I think you understand that pathway and you understand those philosophies. You know, I think about, like, a lot of times in business, I think about these championship caliber businesses, right? These big teams mm-hmm. that put together. As long as somebody wants to be the leader of the band always works, right? And understands what part they're playing. And I think when you look at the current youth group and how things have kind of changed a lot and kind of things a little bit more differently, and there's been a little bit more of this adjustment, when you see young people coming up and trying to get into places like yourself that were trying to get into the league and end up making into the league, what smaller pitfalls that people don't really talk about that is still harmony being true to themselves and that mentality that they can always bring to a consistent table that you would tell these youth people at any level to always have in their mindset, in their arsenal, at anything they're trying to do?
Well, there's a few things that you always have control over. You always have control over your attitude. Mm-hmm. You always have control over your work ethic. And you always have control over, like, your energy that you bring. So if you have a great attitude, if you have a great work ethic, and if you bring positive energy, you're going to always have some form of success. You might not have the greatest form of success because there are other things outside of your control. But the things that you can control, you can always come to work, you know, ready to work hard with a great attitude. Always, always. You can always come to work ready to go above and beyond. If they ask you to do 5 things, knock those 5 things out and do 6 or 7 things, going above and beyond, you know, and having that good energy. Those are things that you can always control, because you can't control, you know, what the person in leadership position is going to do. You can't necessarily control your natural ability. Like, God has given us all natural ability, but there's some people who have even more natural ability, and there's some people who have less. So you have to work with what you have and maximize it. Like me, I only have this one body that God gave me. So I'm just going to maximize it. I'm not 7 feet, but I'm not 4 foot. I am what I am. And so I just try to maximize that. And that's what I would tell any young person who's trying to enter any space. Bring what you bring and work hard and have great energy and a great attitude about it.
Now, this is important because you talked about going the extra mile. And here's where veterans see the difference between rookies. I don't care if it's in business or in basketball, everything else. if you go the extra mile, like we all did, to earn the respect and go from there, you will automatically get the respect and the playing time. So a lot of times, you being the best player isn't what the problem is. It's you being the best fit for the team. And that's in business as well, right? So right. We talk about that mindset. A lot of people don't understand that because they can't articulate and discuss that. You know, when you're walking in and you're doing these amazing projects, you talked about what you're doing at Cleveland State. You talk about where you're sitting at, what you've done for that university. You talk about when Coach Waters picked you up and going from that process, right, and moving that through. Mm-hmm. When you are now at the point of winning and maintaining that caliber, you won your first one, a lot of people fall off. A lot of people lose themselves, right? They forget how they got there. That doesn't matter if you get into the pros. It doesn't matter if you got the new promotion. It doesn't even matter if you got the first $1 billion IPO. They lose themselves. How did you at such a young age maintain yourself and then the following year perform at even a higher level to do what you did?
I feel like part of it is the environment that I was in. Sometimes, you know, you need to put yourself in an environment where the high standard is the high standard. And I was fortunate enough to, you know, with an organization where, you know, with the Heat, it's championship or nothing. That's the standard. We play to championship standard every year. And for me personally, you know, my home life, you know, my father always told me, don't make a good decision, make the best decision. And so I always tried to be the best in anything I did, you know. Now, it doesn't mean I was always going to be the best, but I always had the mentality to strive to be the best. And so, you know, once you have one accomplishment, that accomplishment is done. Now it's time to move forward, because as you know, life is not stagnant. Life is always going to move forward. And so after we, you know, won one championship, you know, after I accomplished, you know, my goals at Cleveland State, you know, life had to continue to go on. So I had to find new goals, new motivation to continue to live up to that standard. And I think, you know, for those who are trying to enter business and those who are trying to become pro athletes or entrepreneurship, put yourself in a high standard environment, because the environment that you're in can determine how high you go. If you're in a average environment or an excuse making environment, then that's going to be your ceiling. You're going to be average. You know, you're going to be able to make excuses sometimes, but if you put yourself in a environment ecosystem of excellence, then that's going to be the standard. And everyone in that ecosystem is going to push each other to stay to that standard. And that was the standard for the Heat. And that was the standard in our household growing up. And that was the standard at Cleveland State and still is the standard.
Man, I love that. And now you're giving back to the university and you've really helped it grow recently. You had visits, you're really putting back to the university, and now you're looking towards education. Tell me about that process and what you're doing there.
Well, it started off organically, just wanting to stay a part of the, you know, the university. It meant so much to me, so I would go back and visit. And then I started speaking to the team and, you know, speaking to them about obviously my success, but encouraging them. And it just became an every year thing. And now it's to the point where, you know, I work with the university on, you know, trying to help them, you know, make some decisions. You know, I'm not the decision maker, but they, you know, bounce ideas off of me. I speak to the student body, encourage them. During the pandemic year, I was a keynote speaker for the graduation class electronically. And so I just want to give back to those who helped me. And I also have experience that not many people have. And so I believe it would be selfish for me to keep it all to myself, you know. So being able to educate those about good habits, about, you know, how to transition through, you know, life as a student athlete, how to excel in your sport and also in the classroom, and how to leverage relationships while on campus. That's something that's important to me. And I want to share, and Cleveland State has given me that platform to share. And then also, you know, partnering with you, you know, having a platform to be able to expand to different universities and put a curriculum together to expand the youth. That's what it's all about, being able to give back to that next generation.
Yeah, it excites me, and I love hearing that about you. And I think that's what drew me so much to you when we've had such a close and quick friendship, is because it was a timing of life. Like we mentioned, what, 3, 4, or 5 years ago, right? And then we stayed in touch, different parts of our lives, and we just finally clicked when timing was clicking and the time was perfect. And I thank, obviously, you know, the stars that put us together going from there. When you talk about the education and giving back and understanding that, what I really love is that you're building this mindset, and it's a championship mindset in business and practice. And you're showing that there are actually connections. The same thing you said, not being selfish, holding these high standards, holding these regards, and not demeaning, but maintaining an integrity, consistency of harmony. Those are the things that you're explaining at a high level of education, now giving back. That's so powerful, Norris. And it's something that we don't recognize often, because that is because you care and you understand that investment. What made you feel that that was so important to you and significant, and why is that beneficial in your opinion to the youth?
Well, I didn't become successful on my own. Somebody helped me, and that's the only way to pay it forward, to pay that back. I can never pay back my parents. It is not enough time on earth to pay them back. I can never pay back the time my coaches spent with me. I can never pay back, you know, the teachers, the professors who helped, you know, invest in me. The only way I can pay that back is to give back to the next generation, because there's nothing that money could buy to pay back my parents. There's nothing that money could buy to pay back the opportunity that Coach Waters gave me to give me my scholarship, to get an education, to get a degree, and then go play in the NBA. I couldn't, there's nothing physically I could give him to pay that back. And so the only way to be able to do that is to give back to those coming behind me, or inspire those who are, you know, my age or older, to inspire them as well. That's the only way, because I didn't make it on my own. And I think most successful people, if they're honest with themselves, understand that they didn't make it on their own. Somebody had to sacrifice and help them. Somebody had to give them the game. Somebody had to give them opportunity. And so I understand that. And, you know, in this world that we live in, we're all teammates. We're all teammates in this world. You know, no matter where you're from, no matter where your background is, as humans, as humanity, we're all teammates, and we have to live in this society. And so I just want to make the society be more efficient. I want to, you know, give people the chance to make whatever choice they're going to make. I just want them to make an educated choice. You know, and so I try to share the information that I've experienced, and then let, you know, whoever's going to hear that information, let them make a decision, an educated decision based off of that.
There we go, my man. You hit it on the dial. You want to have a chance for us to have an educated decision. And I feel like with the way things are brought up, it doesn't matter anything. If you just have a better financial situation, the likelihood is you have the opportunity to have a better education for better educators. We both know this because we've talked about this, and this is absolute truth when I'm teaching, right? I think you see all these amazing minds, and the problem is they don't know that they can do better. They don't know that there is no spoon, that they have the opportunity. So the fact that you understand teamwork, I feel that is a missing ingredient in the current environment and success of most people. Individuals can be great, but in any business without the other people, you just can't be that great, right? There is no greatness that's there. And you've shown that time and time again. You know, dude, when I think about all that, and I put this together in your mind frame or your thought process, you know, when you see giving the opportunity to teach and to educate and to go from there, you see a fundamental shift in culture, right? And like, you've done this. You've seen the world, you've seen different cultures and understood and ascertained that knowledge, and you want to give back. Why is that experience so important? Because I think a lot of times, you and I both as young guys, is we know everything. And then we get older, we know nothing, right? Like, that's what we start talking about. We know nothing. We're talking about, I know nothing. But why is that so important? Because I think that's pivotal to a champion mindset. Could you explain that a little bit to us?
Well, sometimes because we're in certain environments, we've mastered that environment and we think that that's the only thing there is. Like, I'm from Dayton, Ohio. I never really knew I was going to leave Dayton, Ohio. I had never seen anything else. I mean, I had took trips or anything, but I had never lived anywhere but Dayton. And so that's all I could have as a point of reference. And so it's important for those who have been where I'm from and then experience things outside of that, it's important to come back to where I'm from, to share with those around me in my environment that, hey, there is a bigger world out there. And the more experience you have outside of your environment, the more education you have, the more things you have to draw on before you make a decision. And so for me, when I make a decision, I'm not making a decision based off of living in Dayton, based off of living in Ohio. I'm making a decision based off living in Dayton, living in Cleveland, living in Miami, living in Oklahoma City, living in New Orleans, living in Europe, you know, living in Israel, living in Puerto Rico. I'm making a decision based off of all of that, all the information that I have, and then I'll make a decision. And because I have that wide base of being well-traveled, well-cultured, I feel like I can make a better decision because I'm basing it off of a wide range of information. I'm taking all the information, all the experiences, and then I'm gonna try to make the best decision, not just a good decision.
I love that and that mind frame, because with that thought process, the more you learn, you know, yes. People talk about TV and how I learn, and movies and gaming and YouTube and podcasts. Everyone receives and understands entertainment in a certain value. That's what it is. It's what you're receiving, what you're intaking that you want to do. And like you said, the more of that value going from there. Now you're touching about something that is also part of the youth. And we talk about, which is your access now into gaming. Now you are cold-blooded. We have played a couple of games. I'm going to vouch for that online. So that's a big vouch, right?
My cold-blooded 30 is my gamer tag.
Cold-blooded 30.
Yes.
So, Mr. Cold-Blooded 30, you're into gaming. You started playing it again. We started picking up. What is the first thing that you thought to yourself, holy cow, this was a complete misconception of what I thought it was? Now, we're going to ask this in real time, so we never talked about this, so I want to hear what you really thought it was.
So, when I first started playing games as a kid, it was for fun. And, you know, as a kid, you pick up on games easy because that's all you do. You play. You play, you go to school, you play. Now, as an adult, I had took some time off. And so getting back on the game, I was hesitant to do it because I'm like, some of the games are newer. Some of the controllers are, you know, the technology is different. I thought it was going to be terrible. So I was really not excited about getting back into it. But I realized, one, you don't have to be good. It's about interaction. This is the space. If you want to reach the youth, this is one of the major spaces to do. This is where everyone is. So you don't have to be good at it. Two, if you play it enough, you'll eventually get good at it. And three, gaming is not just playing a game. It's like an ecosystem now. It's like a business now. You can have conversations about everything while gaming and streaming. And so just like how I use basketball to get the kids' attention to talk about life, gaming is another way to do that. You use gaming as a way to have something in common. And when you have something in common with a person, it's easier to transfer information to them. They're more open to it. And that's what I didn't really understand about gaming that I understand now. And that's why I'm so into it, you know, and I'm going to continue to be into it.
That excites me, man. I appreciate that.
You know, shout out to Dave, man. You put me up on game. I appreciate you. That wasn't me, ladies and gentlemen. That was the education from Dave. And now I got it.
I appreciate it, man. You know, I always talk about how we're one viral video away from making millions, right? That's always what I say to everybody. The other thing is, when you were at ConnectX, you saw a wide range of people. Now, the first day when you saw everybody, till the end of it, tell me what surprised you from the groups of people that are in gaming, whether it was Neil from Cisco Systems, our boy Marquis from Roland, down to your reaction when you saw Good Burger X. I heard about that. Yes. I want to hear what you thought about that, because I think this is important, and this leads to what you're discussing about the championship mindset side of it.
Well, I learned that there are a lot of different characters, man. Totally different personalities.
But like, totally different.
Totally different. I realized that I wasn't in a room full of, you know, jocks and athletes. I was in a room with charismatic people who don't care what anybody thinks. They're going to stay in character to their character, their social media influence, the crowd that they're trying to reach. They're going to stay in character at all times. And I learned that, like, sometimes you got to be uncomfortable, get outside your comfort system, because I'm not a big talker all the time. As you know, I communicate, but I'm not someone that's going to talk too much, overly talk. I was around people that never stopped talking. And so I had to learn, like, you know what? Sometimes over communicating is how you get information. That's how, you know, sometimes what's not said is that one viral video away. Sometimes you need to go that extra mile and have that extra conversation. You know, I'm not a person that wears a costume, but I do wear a uniform. My basketball uniform, that's my uniform. Well, in content creator world, you can wear a costume at all times. So Kale from Good Burger, he wears his at all times, but he has a following that's loyal to him, millions of followers. And it's like, what you see as a character is not necessarily who he is as a person, but that's his character, and he's very successful. And so that was pretty cool to see him. And you know, you can't judge a book by its cover, because he was really, really cool. And I was like, man, he wears that wig all the time. He ended up being one of the coolest people there. And then obviously, you know, you got Markeith, you know, the coolest dude ever. He got the shades, got the different color hair.
Yeah, all nice.
But when he talks, he's so educated in his field. He's so educated in the realm of technology and music and sound. Very, very well educated. Then you have like Aurora and the guy from Cisco. Like, he was a stand-up comedian.
He's a stand-up comedian. It's like the global guy from Cisco, just stand-up comedian.
Stand-up comedian, but in gaming. Who would ever put that together? So, you know, at Connect X, that's exactly what it was. It was connecting the dots. You know, whoever would have thought, I'm sure they thought like, man, this guy, this basketball player. And then when I spoke, they was like, oh, he has intellect. You know, he's not just a jock. And so being able to put all of us together and get to know one another, that was pretty cool. And I learned a lot from him. And how to step outside of my comfort zone, for sure. I appreciate them being their authentic self.
Yeah, it was amazing, man. Seeing you interacting, you know, having these different levels of people, and it all opened up from gaming, right? Like,
yes. It
all opened from video games, something that we as children thought was a children's thing as an adult. And now we're understanding that as content and content creation and timing. And some of the biggest people are there. And that's amazing. You know, I want to ask you a couple more questions, and I'm going to ask you a couple relevant current questions. What is the current favorite game of yours that you're currently playing?
My favorite game right now, without a doubt, is Call of Duty. Call of Duty is my favorite game. One, it's the game I'm the best in. Two, that's the game that I grew up playing. You know, in college, we played that game a lot. So that's my favorite game. And I know a lot of people that play it, so I have a lot in common with that. I can reach a lot of people with that game. And then I'm getting into the Fortnite space. You know, Fortnite is, you know, probably the biggest game in the world. And so, and you helped me get onto that game. All my little cousins, they play Fortnite. They've been playing for years. And I'm like, what is that game? And then I'm finally starting to get into it. And so I would say Call of Duty and Fortnite are my favorite games. And Crash Bandicoot.
Yeah, I know you like that Crash, man. We got
to
get
that's throwback. That's throwback to the PlayStation. Yeah, I love Crash Bandicoot.
We're going to do that. Let me ask you this. Next question. Where do you think Victor Wembanyama is going to do next year in the league?
I think he's going to have a learning curve. I think he'll average close to a double-double, though. I think, you know, between 16 and 18 points a game. Between 8 to 10 rebounds. And I think defensively is where he's going to be really good. I think he can average, you know, 2 blocks a game, you know, maybe even 3, you know, because defensively he's ready right now defensively. Offensively, I think he's going to have to find his way, but I think he's going to be a special talent in this game.
That's amazing. Now I'm going to do a segment that we call Flash Quick Words. It's going to be one sentence or one word of the individual that we bring up that you think about and their mindset and what you mean to them. I'm going to say their name. You're going to say a sentence and go from there. Pat Riley.
Culture.
LeBron James.
Greatness.
Dwayne Wade.
Sacrifice.
Chris Bosh.
Multi-talented.
Ray Allen.
Shooter.
Fortnite.
Creativity.
Call of Duty.
I had to watch what I was gonna say for the Call of Duty. Maps.
Let's just say Maps. I love it. Maps is the answer.
Hey, I was gonna say shooter, but that, you can't say that. Maps.
We gotta bleep that one out.
I was gonna Maps. They have very creative maps.
Let me ask you. In the future, where you see the NBA and where it's going, what excites you about the future of the NBA?
What excites me about the future of the NBA? I like that the NBA has an open mindset to growth. It's not stagnant. I do like that. It's open to always new ideas of trying to get better. It's open to trying to relate to what's going on, you know, with the players. So from that standpoint, that's what I like, the open-mindedness, the creativity to not being stagnant, to trying to relate to what's going on with the players and what's going on in society. I like that. I like that about the NBA.
I love that. The last thing is, where are you excited about for Norris Cole?
I'm excited about a lot of things. I'm excited about continuing to be healthy. I'm excited about my next journey of continuing to play because I am not done playing.
Amen to that. You can still play, bro. Absolutely.
You know, whoever want to test that theory, y'all give me a chance and I will show you. And I'm also excited about what's next, as far as, you know, being an entrepreneur. That space is a vulnerable space because, you know, in the world of sports and basketball, I know what to do. I know how to train. I know the ins and outs of it. I know how it goes, the business and everything of it. You know, when you move into a new space like entrepreneurship, there is no set way. You know, there's multiple ways of doing it, and sometimes there's trial and error. And so the uncertainty, I'm excited about the uncertainty about it. It's, you know, it makes me nervous sometimes. Like I said, it's a more, you know, you have to be vulnerable in the space of it because there's no guarantees in it. But I'm excited about the possibilities of, you know, striking gold and being able to impact, you know, millions and billions of people with the next entrepreneur moves that that I'm going to do and that we're going to do.
I love that, man. I'm so happy for it. Last question. If you give one piece of advice to everybody, what would that be from Norris Cole to the world?
I would say, well, I'm going to give them two. One, I'm going to say there's no reward without sacrifice. So you have to be willing to pay the price for what you want. And the more that you want, the higher the price that you have to pay. Oof. And so, you know, if you want to live and have rare things and things that not everyone have, you have to be willing to pay the price and do things that not everyone is willing to do. You have to be willing to pay the price. And so, and with that being said, I have a saying that I live by. Sacrifice, give back, and inspire. You have to sacrifice your time and your effort in order to be successful. And once you do that, you give back to those who have helped you. And then you inspire, you know, the next generation to come. And that's what I do. I sacrifice, I give back, and I inspire the people.
Wow, man. So powerful. Two pieces of advice from two-time champion, cold-blooded.
Yes, sir.
Norris, thank you so much for your time. We feel so blessed and honored. We continue and pray to do good things. We can't wait to see what you do in the future. Get your head back on this podcast and talk to you soon. For everybody, for David Chen and the one and only cold-blooded Norris Cole. Before I leave, Norris, give them your social media handles.
So on Instagram, I'm Norris Cole with the blue check mark. And on Twitter, you can put Norris Cole. Also, I had the blue check mark, or my handle is PG_Cole.
PG_Cole. All right, guys. Thank you guys for another edition of Bad Always Podcast. We are excited for the great things that are happening in this world. Stay blessed, stay grateful, and stay compassionate, stay loving.
Oh, I forgot about TikTok too.
Don't forget the TikTok. I'm glad you said it.
Yeah, I forgot about the TikTok. What's the TikTok? I got the TikTok now. TikTok. Yeah, Norris Cole on TikTok as well. I think it's, my handle is Norris Cole 30, but you can just click in my name, Norris Cole, and I'm verified on there as well.
I love it. And stay tuned for that Twitch that we're going to be bringing up to him real soon. Gaming with the big man himself. Thank you guys for a great night. We'll talk to you soon.